for coming. My name is Murali. I work as a software engineer, especially in iOS developer PayPal. Today I'm going to talk about SiriKit integration. The title of the talk is giving every app a voice. The agenda for today is first, I know most of you are experienced developers.
Sorry, you just like speak up a bit.
Oh, yeah.
We really want to hear what you have to say.
Okay, okay.
And take them
up. Sure.
Thank you.
Yeah. I know most of you are experienced iOS developers, but some of you may be new to iOS development, so I want to give a little bit background so that everybody will be on the same page. Okay? And then I'll talk about SiriKit and how to integrate. And finally, I'll use few tips that that can help you on integrating your apps into SiriKit. The background. So it's all started in 2014 WWDC. Any guys can expect what is that? Apple introduced a new feature that everybody was waiting for. App extensions. Before app extensions, there was no way that one can use your app features outside your app. So you have to open your app to see to experience your wonderful features. But if the user is on some other app, so he can't use your application's features. So with the app extensions, Apple introduced a new way of interacting with your apps. Basically, these app extensions it will help you to explore or go beyond your application and expose your particular features so that other applications can also use it. And also, these app extensions are not a full-fledged app applications. They live for a very short time and they are defined for a very limited scope of work. So once the scope of work is finished, that extension gets killed. Nowadays, it became mandatory and must ensure for every iOS apps to have these app extensions, any sort of app extensions. So what are the different type of app extensions that we initially has? Apple started with a small list, like 6 or 7 of them. Today extension, share, action, photo editing, custom keyboard, watch kit, all this. And currently, they have like 19 of them, 19-20. So how does the app extension works? Imagine, let's say, you're browsing through a photo album and you want to send a photo to your WhatsApp friend. Okay, so earlier, how you can do this one was only by opening your WhatsApp, clicking on the chat, importing that particular photo, and then send. So you have to switch between your Photos application and also your WhatsApp. But with the app extensions, you don't have to switch. You don't have to go out of your Photos application to do that. You can use your share extension there, select WhatsApp, and immediately WhatsApp extensions presents inside the context of your Photos application. So once the particular task is over, your WhatsApp extension gets dismissed immediately and you still are in your Photos application. So once user chooses your app extension, system iOS asks to launch the app extension, and app extension runs the code. And once that is finished, system kills the app extension. So, and why I'm talking about app extensions? Because Apple introduced couple of more app extensions last year. For the previous WWDC. They are WatchKit, iMessage, Intense extension, and Intense UI extension. The bottom two are the ones we are using for SiriKit integration. So remember these two, Intense extension and Intense UI extension. So how Siri works? When you talk to Siri, when the speech gets converted into an intent. So the intent being like, what's the purpose user of? What is the task that user wants to achieve? And then that intent gets converted into an action. And that action, after successful or failure, you get a proper response from Siri. So as an app developer, we have to help Siri in the whole process. So by giving first the vocabulary. So this step is to make Siri understand what the user is intending. Like, let's say you have your own messaging app and you have your contact, your spouse's name or somebody's name to save as with some unique to that particular app alone. Like, let's say you save your spouse's name as sweetheart, okay? And in your contact list, it's her name is normal, her name itself. But inside your app, it's saved as sweetheart. But if you say Siri that send my sweetheart so-and-so message via this particular app, there is no way that Siri knows that sweetheart is your this particular contact, right? So that specific app context, app-related terms, everything, you have to teach Siri how to understand that. So here is the step. The vocabulary provides you the space to give Siri that value. And then once Siri understands that intent, it will ask you for verification, like what are the different parameters that the user wants to do. Let's say you are doing a payment application here. So you want to send some money to somebody, and that Siri asks for, is the pay correct? Is that amount is correct? All these different confirmations that will ask for it. And then once all those required conditions are met, Siri performs that action. And finally, with the Siri comes up with the response. And even there, you can provide your own user interface so that Siri can, I mean, you can bring your own custom screens to be in sync with your regular application. So you don't want a Siri Siri to give a different UI rather than, I mean, your own app is giving some other UI, but Siri don't. If you want to bring the same look and feel into the Siri application, you can do that here. So speaking Siri's language. So how does Siri works is like, everything in Siri falls into domains. Domains is a set of group of items that Siri can understand and it knows how to talk about them. So currently Siri has 6 different domains. It supports messaging, voice calling, payments, workouts, ride booking, and photo search. If your app or some of your app's functionality falls into any of this bucket, then you are a good eligible candidate for Siri integration. Inside domains, you can have a group. You can have many actions, or they call it as intents. I'll go with a small example here. Let's say I want to send some money to Sub for some other. So when I say, hey Siri, send $20 to Sub on PayPal for the gift. So with this speech, with this sentence, Siri understands that this particular request belongs to payments domain. And it identifies that it has a send payment intent, because there is a word send, so amount is there, right? So based on that, it gets that intent. And we have to use PayPal application. And pay is soup, amount $20. And currency, here is the interesting thing, because you never mentioned that you have to send it in Singapore dollars, right? You said only $20, but Siri is, based on your location, Siri identifies that you may be asking for Singapore dollars rather than US dollars. So Siri provides that as well. And finally, Siri also notes the note, or what is the purpose of this request for the gift. So I'll talk about intent a little bit, because intent is the particular action that you want the Siri to perform. Each intent can have 0 to many parameters. In the previous example that we have seen, right, it has like 5 or 6 parameters. It depends on your scenario and different domains. You can have you can have no parameters to up to some particular many parameters. And always intent classifies into a particular domain. So first identify the domain that your particular feature belongs to, and then you raise your domains and raise your intents based on that. And then once Siri finds out the intents and asks you for that, and then you have to give Siri back the intent response. So how you are handling the response intent, you have to give back Siri that information with the format intent response. So in that you give different response codes, and you also has to give NS user activity. How many of you are aware of NS user activity? Okay, so NS user activity is nowadays widely used in iOS applications. You would know of handoff, right? So if you're performing some app, some task on some place, and then immediately if you go to your own application and you can pick up the same task from there. So NS user activity can be useful there. So for sending payments to somebody, let's say if you ask Siri to send money, and then for some reason the request failed, you don't want the user to again key in the amount and selecting the payee, all these details, right? So you can use NS user activity to get the details wherever he has earlier. So then pick it from there, and you can directly open your app and show that screen, so that user can perform the request continuously. Intents life cycle. Basically, intents has 3 stages in its life cycle. First one is resolve. So resolve is a place where Siri asks you to ask for the different, based on the user's request, you have to help Siri to understand those parameters that you have given. So the resolve is the step where Siri asks you for that, and you will respond with resolution responses. There are different types of resolution responses. So let's say in the previous example, Siri identifies that Sub, the name, the contact name, the payee name Sub, as particular. It is saved as Sub in my contact list. Then there was no question. It is straight away successful. So we'll respond back with success. Let's say in the contact list, Sub's name is saved with his full name. So Siri asks for a confirmation. Do you meant by this person? So we have to reply back with the confirmation required for that with this one. Then sometimes there may be 2 or 3 names matching with that name. So you have to give disambiguation requests with. And if you are not sure if there are hundreds of items matching with that particular name, then you cannot provide all the 80 or 100 list of names to user to scroll through, right? So you need some more details. So you reply back with that. And if any required field is missing from your request, then you can ask for that. It's a needed field. And if it is any unsupported, then you can also tell that. And if any field is not required, you can say it is not required, so Siri won't prompt the user to give that particular parameter. For this send payment intent, the protocol that the different resolve steps are defined in this in send payment intent handling function. So if you see the functions, different functions available there, there are like resolve payee, resolve currency amount, resolve note. So based on your intent, these different methods will, be changed. And confirm, the next step is confirm. Confirm is a stage where you do 2 different types of actions. So you have to tell Siri that what is the expected action of the intent, so that Siri will show a confirmation screen to the user with all these details. And this is the place where you check for your requested. Let's say you are sending a payment, then you have to be login, right? This is the place you check whether the user is logged into your application. Also, your backend servers are available for the contact, and also whether he has a sufficient balance in his wallet. All these different checks you can make here, and you will reply back with the intent responses. And for certain domains, the confirmation step is not necessary, but for domains like payments and all, this step is mandatory. So you don't want somebody to send money without user confirmation, right? So here is a protocol that we have to look into. In the send payment intent handling, there is a method for confirmation. And based on the intent, we have different response codes available. So there are quite a good number of predefined response codes. Some of them are like amount below minimum, amount above maximum, currency is not supported. And these are some certain number of predefined and most useful, most frequently used error codes in the error codes or response codes for this particular domain. So based on the different domains, you will have a different set of error response codes. Response codes. And as I spoke earlier, like this is the place where you check all your services are available, whether the user is not is logged in or not. If not, or if you want to make sure that user has to authenticate, you can integrate with your local authentication Touch ID framework to prompt for the authentication there. And the final step is to handle. This is the place where Siri actually performs the requested action. That means it actually sends money by calling your network APIs. For network calls, Siri provides a waiting UI. Like if it is going to take 2 or 3 seconds of time, then Siri gives you this type of one waiting UI with a loader and all this. If a particular request is going to take longer time than 2 or 3 seconds, you can also send Siri that in progress status code, so that Siri tells the user that even if he closes Siri application, Siri experience, his request is still in progress. He can open his app and see the transaction is completed. This is a particular method for handling in payments. How to add SiriKit? So remember, there's two intent extensions, and there are some app components that also you can do with while for integrating your application. Intense extension, Apple has launched this new Intense extension, and it can support more than one intent in a single extension. So based on your domain, if you see here, there are intents supported in the playlist, there are attributes. So you can have send payment intent, and also you can have receive payment intent, like that. And if you are developing a voice calling application, then you can have a audio calling and video calling intents in the same intent extension, rather than having two different intent extensions for each of them. You can put them in a single umbrella. And security, you don't want certain features to be exposed without security. So Apple has added that with the security. So the default one they give you is intents restricted while locked, so that if you add your particular intent into that group here, then it won't allow the user when the device is locked. And this is the place where we actually implement the resolve, confirm, and handle steps that we previously discussed. And then we can have our own intents UI extension. which is an optional one. If you want to bring your own interface or own custom branding experience to Siri, you can use this Siri Intensity UI extension. And you can also choose to replace some of the Siri generated UI, and you can have your own ones there. And next step is vocabulary. Vocabulary is basically divided into two categories. One is app specific one, one is users, and another one is user specific one. If the app specific ones, regardless of the user, all the users of your application knows about those words. So then that is a place for your app specific vocabulary. You have to define them in the main app bundle, not in your extension bundle, because Siri gets this vocabulary from your using this in vocabulary API from your main app, so that it updates itself, updates frequently. And there will be cases with user specific vocabulary. So in that we have to provide in an ordered set. Let's say in my contacts, I have some favorites and recent contacts. They have to be given higher priority when I talk about, when I request for a particular action. Those frequent contacts or favorite items has to be given higher priority over the remaining ones. So we have to provide them in an ordered set of terms. And finally, I'll end up with a few tips. In order to work with any extensions, you have to move your core functionality into embedded frameworks rather than having your code duplicating everywhere for each and every extension. It's always better to have an embedded, a separate framework that every extension or every app can reuse that. And also, I forgot to mention, add one more here. It's better to have your deep linking capability available for your application so that navigate from one place to any other place easily without going through same steps again. So let's say my payment is failed. I can ask user to open the app directly there itself from the Siri experience. Directly it can go to my sending money page screen. So if deep linking is not supported, then you might be, it's very difficult to go to that screen directly. And the second point is user must say your app name. So if you have any very fancy app names that user can't even pronounce those, please avoid those, because it's very mandatory for the user to pronounce that one. Request authorization. Like any other Apple features or Apple iOS frameworks, you have to get the user's confirmation for this particular features to be accessed. And the next one is, group multiple intents into a single extension where possible. So if you are using a VoIP calling kind of app, then don't put too many extensions, intents extensions into spread across, because whenever Siri is launched, your intents extension gets called, is in active mode in the background. The process keeps running. So if you have too many intents extensions running behind, so that will drain the battery and all other problems will come for the user. So better to put them in a single umbrella wherever it is possible. And the next one is, user activity. Use the NS user activity and pass it in the intent response so that user can pick the same request from requesting your in your main app. And this is one more important thing. If you have your vocabulary added into your app, right? So you have to update Siri whenever there is a new item added or deleted from that one. Let's say I removed a contact name from my contact book, and if when I ask Siri, if Siri still shows that particular contact name, it won't look good to the, it won't give you a proper user experience. So that's why you have to update Siri whenever there is a change in your vocabulary. And also, don't forget to reset your vocabulary list when the user is logged out of your application. You don't want to show user-specific vocabulary to other users. And also, the final thing, you can provide some useful examples and have it in your main app bundle, so that whenever user asks Siri what you can do for me, then it will show along with all the Apple iOS applications, it will also include your particular app also, and also user can see how can he use that one. Otherwise, there is no way that user can know that your app is supporting SiriKit. And what to expect from Apple in future? Maybe currently this domains, I know it's very limited, it's only 5 or 6 of them, but maybe they will increase this to multiple domains. How many of you know about Bus Uncle, Facebook chat, Messenger, bot, Bus Uncle? Yeah, so you can ask, I mean rather than, you can, with the Bus Uncle you can ask when is the next bus coming, right? So same way you can ask, maybe in future you can ask Siri to directly ask when is the next bus coming. So it will show, rather than opening some SDMRT or some apps, you can expect those. And maybe they will give some standalone application extensions, because we have seen this one in the iMessages extension already. iMessages extensions are, you don't need to have your main application. You can only have your extension app alone. So maybe they can support this one. Because there's one reason is, like, I feel it for the watch, for the Apple Watch, currently you have to have one main app also running on your mobile. So maybe Apple can remove that requirement. Thank you. And if you have any questions. Yeah, SiriKit.framework.
SiriKit.
Yeah.
Then the second question is, if you make a payment, like, is there any security measure that prevents another person from taking the phone and payment?
Yeah, you can add your touch ID there. So you have to authenticate with your fingerprint. I mean, the touch ID thing. So touch ID is nowadays the most secured way of securing the aspects, right? So
how does it work with other languages?
It works almost with all the Siri supported languages. And if you have any app specific vocabulary, so you have to put them in a main bundle, and also you can localize them so that Siri can understand with all the other languages also. So you can have different languages with different vocabulary.
Do you have any experience to share about testing this? Like, you know,
we
were testing manually or
something? Yeah, we were testing it manually. So, yeah, we're not sure anything available.
Yeah.
Because even Apple was suggesting to test it very rigorously. They have not mentioned what tools we can do, but they said you have to give it to most of the people, and it's not like any simple, you have to take care about the user's accent, all this, right? So the many people that you give it to for testing, the better result you will get.
And you
know,
whatever, if you want to
say
the domain, for example, say currently they only allow the domain, and say taxi, but let's say I want to claim my own thing, you know, to pass it. And I will use the taxi domain, but I'll use it something like bus timetable or something like that. Can you do something like that?
I got this weird idea, but not tried. But the intents are very tightly bound, linked with the domains. So you can only have particular intents, and the request, the resolve step, it will give you only for specific to those particular intent. So it won't give you a general generic object so that you can use it for anything. So it, they are very tightly mounted one. Yeah.
Do you have a staging and production app and you get confused?
For this particular one?
Yeah.
All our apps are a couple of stages.
Like staging, like a development app.
Yeah.
So you have your official 1.0 and your development app. I mean, it's up to CV, it picks the production one.
That depends on your main app, which one it is connected to.
Okay.
So we have, like I said, we have a development and a release separate branches. Each one points to different stages.
Let's say
you're
developing a new product,
right? From extension, I've not tried that.
Let's
but
say a false object or something. Let's say I'm sending a message in background from Siri. So I need to access that false object right from there.
Yeah, I think it's possible, but I've not tried one on my own.
You have tried any problem?
For the SiriKit integration or any normal extension?
Siri
extension. Siri extension. Maybe, I'm not sure, but I can check that one.
Have you done something like that? Sending some data to server from SiriKit extension?
From SiriKit, no.
No.
We are not trying.
Now, some of the recent App Store review guidelines for apps that support SiriKit,
Review this is like, to start with, I mean, you can basically integrate almost any particular apps with the domain with a single step, like the resolve step. And so you don't have to provide a vocabulary, and also this providing you a custom UI, they are not mandatory ones. So
they haven't asked me any specific for apps that supports you.
No.
You said that Siri infers certain information, like symbols. Is there any way I can train that if certain words come in, then expect to use this particular
order? You can use the resolve step. So Siri will tell you that a user requested for this particular amount, and also if that particular currency is, I mean, this all comes in a there's a money object, IN money or something. So that will have the amount in decimals and also with the currency code. So if your app doesn't support that particular currency code, you can you can respond back with the default ones you can. Thank you.